you know it's funny, like Lisa Sargent there, and I was just like, Lisa's been trying to get me on a guest, and it's someone called Dr. Dave Smith or something like that. And then I thought, oh yeah, I thought, because I just haven't had time to look at the video. Apparently Lisa did a good video that she's going to edit down. Apparently people confronted this guy, Dr. David Smith, and I you know, and I saw Lisa copied me on an email trying to get this guy on. And once I realized who this guy was, I was like, Lisa, there's no way in hell this guy's going to come on, because he is a chief executive of a local council, in this case, Thurrock Local Council in Essex. And the reason why these people won't come on is because they are very much entrenched. They are a vital part of the establishment. So if people don't know, a chief executive of a council is essentially the Sir Humphrey Appleby equivalent in a local council. They're the top civil servant of the local council, of any of your local councils that you guys are paying via taxpayers, via council tax. So if I just type in, for example, Thurrock, let's just say Thurrock chief executive, right? And I'll get it up on the screen here. Let's just swipe. Let us see. So this is, let me just show you what I'm talking about here. So Lisa's been trying to get her on, fair play to her. She's been trying to get this Dr. Dave Smith, you see down here, is the current holder of the chief executive role. If you look here, I mean, and this is in every council, guys, as in all of your councils, etc. According to the available information, Lynn Carpenter was the chief executive of Thurrock Council until her resignation in December 2022, citing a $469 million black hole in the council's finances. So keeping in mind, these people are terrible at their job. They're like all state, all government is terrible at balancing books, because they do not operate on a profit loss model, because it doesn't matter how bad they do or how well they do, it is irrelevant. They will always get money. So what's the incentive of actually doing a good job? So regardless if I do a bad job or regardless if I do a good job, I'm still going to get exactly the same money. Whereas in the private market world, if you do a bad job, you will go out of business and you will lose your job. So there is an incentive to always improve. That's why private sector is always superior to national sector. That's why people go, we need the trains to be renationalized. It's like, why? They'll be just as bad, if not worse. Prior to her resignation, she held a position to an unknown date. During her tenure, Lynn Carpenter's salary was publicly disclosed, revealing she earned £171,501 in 2017/2018, which is almost £22,000 more than the Prime Minister's salary at the time. So every single chief executive in the country, every single council, get more money than the Prime Minister. Yet they do not hold a national role that the Prime Ministers hold. Why is that? Because prime ministers are essentially just puppets. They are the approved scapegoats of the day. So we all send our hate and direct our hate at Keir Starmer at the moment. Keir Starmer is a puppet. All these people are puppets, whether it's Rishi Sunak, whomever before, Tony Blair, you know, Boris Johnson, whoever it is. They're just the scapegoat people. They are the PR of the state. They're the face of the state. But really, so why do these guys who do less work, because obviously again, the prime minister is in charge of the country, whereas chief executive are only in charge of a small geographical area of countries, and yet they get more money because they're the real players, because they're the ones who are actually making the decision. All of these like people who are elected councillors, well, it's a joke. The whole thing is a joke. It's giving the illusion that you live in a democratic society and therefore you should pay your tax. But it's all just a con. It's a scam, the whole thing. After her resignation, Dr. Dave Smith was appointed to the Managing Director Commissioner of Thurrock Council in 2023. As part of the role, he fulfilled duties as chief executive. It was worth noting in Carpenter's that. So where is, where I saw, where was it that I sent Lisa? That, basically, that figure has, I hope we, at least I'm sure we won't mind, just sharing a message. There's nothing naughty been said or anything like that. So this is it here, from my phone. For some reason it's not doing it on my desktop. September 2023, the chief executive salary was increased by 4%, resulting in a new salary of £207,000, despite the council's debt-ridden situation. Firework has gone bankrupt. So the council's going bust. It was already going bust with Lynn Carpenter, where it had, what was it, millions, hundreds of millions in the black, in debt. And they decided to increase their salary to 200,000. So basically, the person who is currently in charge of Borough Council, think about this logically. Why would they come on UNM? Why would they jeopardize their six-figure salary of nearly £250,000 of your taxpayers' money? Why would they jeopardize that by coming onto UNM?
Dr. David Smith, who is the CEO of Borough Council, so if you'd like to give your presentation. And Dr. Dave and Cleo, would you mind if that when you're doing your presentation, if people ask questions as you go along rather than questions right at the end, because it, you know, it seems to work a little bit easier that way. You're okay? All right. Thank you. Yeah. He's going to do it for both of you. You're going to keep an eye on it. There. Okay. Fair enough. No, yeah, you probably can.
Good evening, everybody. And thank you very much for the invitation to come.
Thank you.
Really grateful for it. Just by way of introduction, as the chair said, I'm Dave Smith. I'm actually appointed by the government as what's called a commissioner. So when the council went bankrupt and the government took over the council, I was appointed to come in and help the council sort out its problems. And as the chair's already said, I'm also the chief executive council. I just thought I'd spend a few minutes introducing the issues around the council so you've got some context, against which obviously I'm sure there'll be lots of questions that you want to raise about what's happening at the moment. So as I'm sure everybody knows, the council fell into essentially bankruptcy when it ended up with a debt of £1.5 billion. I know these are figures incredibly difficult to get your head around what that means, but essentially, the best way I can explain it to you is to say that of everything the council had each year, it was having to spend over 40% of everything it had just paying the interest on the debt that it had. So instead of spending all that money on services, it was having to pay the interest on the debt, spending just under half of everything it earned. And it was not sustainable in that situation, so the government took it over, and it's only really working at the moment because it gets a loan from government each year to help keep services going. The council made some grave errors of judgment, some really serious errors of judgment in getting into that position. And of course, on the council's behalf, I just wanted to say sorry to all of you. Because at the end of the day, you and on everybody else in Thurrock is paying the penalty of the council's poor management and poor decision making that led it into that situation. They took out loans over a period of about 4 or 5 years and invested it in companies with the intention that that would give them a return on that investment, an income. And they were using that money to prop up services. Most of the country, as you know, through nearly 15 years of austerity, have been cutting back services year on year for years. This council tried to buck that trend, tried not to cut services by coming up with a scheme to loan money, to borrow money, and invest it in companies to give it an income.
Is that an historic council that used that?
Yeah. Others did it to a smaller degree.
Yeah.
But Thurrock went a lot further than anybody else. Not in one go, but over like a 4 or 5 year
period. Slow down without someone looking at the button. You know what?
So what we found was, whilst the finances are the headline, everybody hears about the finances, exactly to your point. What lies behind that issue is really two things. That the councils, normally councils have a whole set of checks and balances, ways of making sure the decisions that are being taken are sensible and can be scrutinised and can be challenged.
They weren't.
Those sorts of normal checks and balances over the whole of that period are sort of become less and less powerful, less and less influential, to the point where they weren't functioning at all. So there was nobody challenging the decisions.
Yeah.
And also, the other thing that we found was, as well as that, just really poor leadership at the council, both politically and managerially at the time.
One at a time, please. And I'd like you to go
back to back. I can only answer one question.
Yeah, come on, it'd be fair.
That was wrong, you're going to, I don't know, like, say my band can't work anymore, or is anything actually done on people that might be?
So several things have been done. Firstly, obviously, people have gone who were responsible. Some of those people have been...
They were allowed to go, though, weren't they?
I'm happy to answer your question, but can I answer the question first? So, some of those people, we've taken civil proceedings against them as a council, so we're suing them. Others, we've referred to their professional bodies, who will make a judgment about whether they can ever work again within the field. And we've also passed all the information that we've gathered from the council to the police, who are considering whether there is grounds to pursue criminal prosecutions of any or all of those individuals. Obviously, that's a police matter, but we've passed that information.
There are ongoing things going
on. Right, please hold on now. Now, look, we don't need this. Just ask a question, and if Dr. Dave answers, then give someone else a chance. Yeah, I know. We're asking questions as we go along. You're taking up all the floor at the moment.
He's saying everything he did was above board. Are we able to get any of that money back? What exactly is happening? Because we obviously residents put a petition to the council in order to have a proper speaking of it. So, yes. What do you want to tell me?
So, the council is suing Mr. Cavanagh. Mm-hmm. So, we're litigating against him in the courts at the moment. Our intention is obviously to recover as much of the money as we can if we're successful through the litigation.
And the lady here made some very good points. But when I worked at the council nearly 20 years, we had an excellent director of finance, David Lapp, who wouldn't have allowed councillors to get in this state. So what are you saying the councillors didn't listen to the director of finance, or was he as bad as they were?
He was definitely, in my view, in terms of what's in the best value inspection report, responsible for the decisions that were made as an individual. He made what turned out to be catastrophic decisions around the investments he made, and also how they were being accounted for. And the responsibility of the members at the time was that they weren't sufficiently challenging him and scrutinising him and holding him to account for why he thought what he was doing was the right thing. So I think there was culpability on both sides. Both.
And has he been sacked now, or has he been
So he has been sacked. He's gone.
He's not getting pension.
Oh, I couldn't come and say that. I don't know. But he's been referred to as professional body, accountancy body. So which are investigating him.
Mine was just to say right at the beginning, how on earth, over so many years, does such criminal activity carry on and we all pay the penalty for it? And it seems to me that nobody is being held accountable for it. We get all these excuses. At the end of the day, if I walked in, stole somebody's money, I would really find myself in a court of law and have to account for this. And it seems to me that, well, thoroughly, we can just let fire go by the by, because these people were not doing their job right, but however, they can still walk away and have freedom. And I don't understand, even in my tiny mind, how on earth that happens. And one more thing, and it's been my bone of contention for so many years, I don't understand. We had Stanford-le-Hope, which is where I grew up. It was a thriving bit when I was young, and obviously it progressed. They knocked houses down, built them, had a car park, sold off a car park. Now, Stanford, you can't go into Stanford and park in the car park because some criminal activity owns that. And every time somebody goes in there, there's a big fine. It's you've only got to go to Stanford, you can look at a car park centre because nobody wants to go in there and have this where some whoever owns it. But there used to be a man at a gate, you'd go in and pay, you'd get the ticket, you pay your money, fine. I understand there's a station, and so you have to do it that not all the commuters fill it up, but it's standing empty. Somebody somewhere in the council sold off that land. Now, how does that all happen? All the shopkeepers, nobody can park. It's criminal. It's all criminal activity, and it seems to me that nobody's been held accountable for it.
That was an asset disposal by a chap that you're quite right, Linda, that sold off very, very cheap, exceptionally cheap, and there's been controversial ever since, as you know.
And he walked away from that.
And he walked away from that. So these are things that's happened before, you know. It seems to be an ongoing thing, the council, when they had an asset disposal before, there was issues, you know, and people were saying, that's been sold off exceptionally cheap. You know, there we are. For example, the one of the ladies, can I have quiet, please? The one the lady was talking about was in the high street. That was sold off, I believe, for £350,000, something stupid like that, with planning permission for a supermarket, underground car parking, and a couple of flats. I mean, that's crazy for that type of money. It was questioned then, but realistically, nothing was done about it. I know it's before your time, but this is all leading up to, you know, other things, if you like.
One thing at the end, Stanford Railway Station.
if we do that in the A13, then we'd be in for a fortnight.
They must say
thorough
and easy target.
We just milk them. I understand the strength of your feeling about these issues. Obviously, I can't turn the clock back. I can't redo previous decisions. Nor can I take a view, as you're entitled to, about whether something's criminal or not. That's a judgment for the police to make. What I can say from my point of view is that the actions taken, certainly with regard to these investments, was extremely ill-advised. It led to a situation that all the current financial issues for the council, and everybody understands and recognises that. Whether it marks for criminal activity, I can't comment.
Well, you can,
but I'd ask you to be criminal careful. Activity. Yeah, I'd ask you to be careful about that. No, actually, as I said, I totally understand where you're coming from. All I can say to you is that we have put robust processes in, so when we are transacting land sales or dealing with planning applications, we're absolutely dealing with them in a transparent, open way. We're doing the same process. Claire's leading the process at the moment that's uncovering and dealing with all the legacy we've got about Section 106 agreements and all the issues that various communities have got about agreements that they perceive were made and they're not acted on and what's happened to them. So we're turning all those stones over, we're looking at them all and addressing them each by as we come across them.
When you were first asked to do the job, obviously you were aware and made aware of your terms of reference.
Yes.
In your terms of reference, did you or have you the power to the people that were responsible for this demise, either councillors, officers, did you have the power given to you to sack them?
Well, certainly not councillors, I don't know. Because there isn't a legal way of
so you didn't have to that part of your terms of reference to take the people that you found and that unequivocally responsible, you never had the power to take them to start.
No, because the power doesn't exist in law.
It doesn't exist in law.
Okay. You can say the power.
No, I'm just asking the question. I don't know the answer. That's why I'm asking the question. You know, to me, if you give it a terms of reference, it's clearly saying to me, what did you bring it? Against the law. Okay, I accept that. Whether that's right or wrong, another issue.
Yeah.
It's just something that came up earlier. You said you're not in a position to sack councillors. So, if for argument's sake, this inquiry and the police and everything else, they are found to be taking part of it, guilty or whatever, what happens to them then? Oh, now you're testing my if somebody gets a custodial sentence, prison sentence over a certain length, then they can't serve as a councillor, so they can't stand. What I can't remember is how long the sentence has to be. It has to be a custodial sentence of a certain length, and then they can't stand as a councillor. So if they was proved that they knew about it, took part in it, you didn't get a custodial sentence, they can still stand for a council. But they could stand. I think they might technically lose their... I don't want to mislead you, sorry, I'm just trying to remember, because it seems to me that if you're a criminal and you're not found definitely guilty, you can come back and do the same crime again. It sounds ridiculous, you know. There are limits, legal limits as to what can apply to councillors at any election. Yeah,
member. Councillors can't have a criminal record, but MPs can.
don't go there, councillor. Yeah.
But an independent inquiry would look at all those aspects. Why did people leave? Why didn't people put their head above the parapet and ask questions?
Okay.
Is it because they're going to get sacked? Because the drawbridges all come up.
But you're asking me, and I don't know the answer. I don't know when councillors never met. I can only deal with what I can.
You still what's left, though.
Which is why I've drawn the conclusion that all those things had, over a period of time, didn't happen overnight, over a period of time, were taken away. You know, they all just stopped being there.
I think we all know. Alex, we all know realistically. Communication, and we know the lady, I knew the lady quite well. I was councillor, and to my mind, she knew everything that was happening at that council. So, you know, but that's not for Dr. Dave or Claire to answer. John, you come back.
Just
in.
To follow up with where I was. Yes. During this period where these things were going on, there was obviously meetings going on. Were they recorded, hard copy, or stored on cloud, and do they still exist now?
Well, certainly a written copy, because if they're meetings of the cabinet or the council or scrutiny or audit, those are recorded meetings. There may only have been written records. I can't remember going back whether there was then the access to web recordings, but certainly there is a record of those meetings.
And how long statutory would that
be? Oh, for years. They're still there. They're still
right. So if other people did want to do investigations, they will be able to get that information.
Yeah, a lot of it will be on the website already.
Yeah.
If not on the website, there'll be a record somewhere.
You know, there's only one thing that I'm not clear about.
And a footnote to it all.
So we're all tree killers together.